हेलो फ्रेंड्स, वेलकम टू अनदर एपिसोड ऑफ ओपन सूजे और सूजे हाई एबिलिटी क्लस्टर और पेस मेकर। इन टूडेज एपिसोड विल बी डिस्कसिंग अबाउट द हाई एबिलिटी क्लस्टर आर्किटेक्चर एंड वेरियस कॉम्पोनेंट्स ऑफ इट। सो बिफोर स्टार्टिंग विद दैट, यू आर लेट मी वेलकम यू टू माई यूट्यूब चैनल टीच टेक इंस्टीट्यूट, एंड दिस इज अ ट्यूटोरियल चैनल विच यू कैन सब्सक्राइब एंड लर्न वेरियस इमर्जिंग टेक्नोलॉजीज। सो लेट्स स्टार्ट विद द ट्यूटोरियल। So this is the overview of the HA cluster architecture. So you can see there are three components. One is the messaging or membership layer, that is the lowest layer, green color you can see here. Then on top of that you have the resource allocation layer, and on top of that resource layer. So messaging or membership layer mostly consists of CoroSync, whereas resource allocation layer consists of StoneIt, CRM, CIB, PE, LRM, all those things. And resource allocation, resource layer is obviously consists of the resource script. And you have, and this cluster has a storage component also, where you have the DLM and CLVMD or LVM logd. So here you can see your messaging or membership or you say infrastructure layer, that is CoroSync, whereas resource layer is your allocation layer is pacemaker, and resource allocation layer is your resource script. And this all this component you can see LRM, PE, StoneIt, CRM. So we will see in details about them in our upcoming slides. So first we will see messaging or membership layer. So as you can see in this layer, CoroSync is the main component, which is the group communication system. Using the CoroSync only, cluster communicate with each other, and it sends out messages like here messages means the health message, like okay, the node is alive or node is not functioning properly. Then it can use multicast or unicast for this communication. If you are using multiple cluster in the same network, you should use unicast, where it is more secure and only the node inside the cluster can communicate with each other. Whereas if you are not that much concerned about the security, or you don't want to go for that much complexity, you can use multicast to configure the communication between the nodes. And one more thing I need to tell you here, the CoroSync, which is the main component of this messaging or membership layer, systemd has a separate service for that, the same name, that CoroSync only. So you can do systemctl start CoroSync, stop CoroSync, or restart CoroSync, like that. So you can manage with systemd. So let's move ahead with the resource allocation layer. So as you can see, it has various components like cluster resource manager, that is CRM. Then you have cluster information base, that is CIB, designated coordinator, that is DC, policy engine, that is PE, and local resource manager, that is LRM. So we will see in details about these components in our upcoming slides and what is the use of them. First start with the cluster resource manager. So SUSE uses pacemaker as its CRM. So pacemaker is the main component for your resource management in SUSE high availability cluster, and CRM is actually the main controlling process in your Linux cluster, and every resource allocation layer action is handled by CRM. So CRM is the main component who handles all the resource allocation, like which resource will be running on which node or what will be the state. All those things are decided by CRM. So all the communication in resource allocation layer and higher layer passes through the CRM. So nothing get bypass of CRM. So every communication, everything should be done via CRM only, and it maintains and manages the cluster information base. So you'll know what is the cluster information base in our upcoming slides. And one CRM in cluster promoted to the designated coordinator. So here one thing I need to tell you, all the nodes have their own version of CRM running on them, and one of the node get promoted to the designated coordinator. So we'll see what is this designated coordinator also, so don't worry about that. And here I need to tell you that daemon for CRM is CRMD. So if this daemon is not running, your cluster communications and all will not happen properly. So if you do causing restart and all, this daemon also get restarted. So remember one more thing, pacemaker has his own daemon called pacemaker. So you can do like system CTL start pacemaker, stop or restart pacemaker. Now as you saw last slide, like cluster information base, what is cluster information base? So this is the XML representation of cluster. In older versions you see like some static text file you see for cluster configuration, right? How you see in Red Hat, like it is cluster.conf. But in pacemaker they went to totally different approach and they made the configuration file as a XML file which contains the configuration of the cluster and also the current state, like okay, cluster is running or not, which resource is running, or they are in maintenance mode or standby mode. All those information also you can find inside CIB, and it contains definitions of various things like all the cluster options and then all the nodes, how many nodes are part of this cluster, what is the state and all, and all the resources where they should run, what is the interrelationship between them, then any constraint, or you can say like condition is there or not constraint and all. You'll see in more details in our upcoming videos where we'll be discussing about more on constraint, and then relationship between these nodes and their resources, like which resource should run on which node or should not run on which node. All those information you'll find it in CIB. So continuing with the CIB, the designated coordinator, this term also you have heard in previous slides, like DC. So this CIB is always maintained by DC and it maintains the master copy. So one node, whoever is the designated coordinator, it will have the master copy of CIB, and then that copy get replicated to all other nodes. So remember, all the nodes hold their own copy of CIB. It's not like it's only stay in one node, whoever is the master or DC, is being replicated to all the nodes. And the CRM on DC pushes out the changes. So whatever changes you are making, like you are migrating a cluster resource and all those changes you are doing, right? So that changes get pushed from the DC to all other nodes. And the working copy, whatever is the current copy, that stays in the memory, and also there is a backup copy which stays in the disk on every node. So now you are curious about what is designated coordinator or DC. So designated coordinator DC is nothing but is one of the CRM which is decided by an election. So whenever you form a cluster and you join the nodes, they take a participation in a election and they decide which node to be the designated coordinator. So what does, so it gets select from all the nodes. It's not like only particular one node will get selected as a DC. Any of the nodes, suppose you have a 10 node cluster, so any of the 10 node can be a DC, and this election takes place every time you change a membership status. So suppose you are having 10 node, you add another 2 node into that existing cluster, so again this election will take place and it will decide who should be the designated coordinator. What is the work of this? This decides if a cluster wide change must be performed, like how you are seeing right in previous slide, the CIB is maintained and managed by DC, this designated coordinator, and this designated coordinator also decides whether if you are making a change, that change will be replicated to all entire cluster or not. So like example, you can say like you are doing a movement of resource from one node to another node, or you are fencing a node. So this is like an entire cluster related activity. So this thing designated coordinator will be performing. And as you will learn already in previous slide, so this maintains the master copy of CIB. So whatever changes happen, so it gets into the CIB and then that gets replicated to all other nodes. Now designated coordinator, you have seen CRM, you have seen CIB. Now there is one more important component, that's called policy engine. So this policy engine runs on the designated coordinator node. So suppose you have 3 node cluster and your second node become DC. So in that case, PE also, this policy engine also will be running on that node. So when there is a change required, so it calculates the next state of cluster, like based on the current state and configuration. Like suppose your already applications are running, means the resource are running. So in that case, it's going into suppose next state, like suppose stopped. So decide that next state, and accordingly takes the actions, and it creates a transition graph which contains like your list of resource actions and list of dependencies, like the resource, how many actions it can perform, like start, stop, or should be running on all the nodes, all those things, that actions, and also dependencies. Like suppose you are putting your, let me give you an example, like you are putting your web server as a clustered resource. So what you do, first you put your shared file system, then you put your virtual IP, then you put your web service to be coming up. So without your file system, your web content will not be accessible to that active node. So there is no point of starting the web service there. So this is like a dependency. So these dependencies are getting calculates via policy engine. Then you have local resource managers, like you have heard about CRM, that cluster resource manager. Similarly, each node has a local resource manager or LRM. So this receives request from the CRM, like CRM sends a request, like okay, you need to start the service or you need to stop the service. So these actions, whatever you need to do, it gets those requests from CRM, and then it calls the local resource agent. So how the flow will be? Flow will be like CRM sends request to LRM, then LRM calls local resource agent or RA and perform the actions. And it can perform some task on the resource agents, like it can start, it can stop, it can monitor. So all these things it can do. And it is a authoritative about the state of resource on the local node. One more thing I will tell you, that LRM is not aware about the cluster resource or cluster, is not directly maintained by cluster. So it's not like okay, your service is running or not, it doesn't matter on that. It gets all the information from CRM. So if CRM is the controlling mechanism for LRM. Now you have the upper layer, that is resource layer. So in resource layer you have one or more resource agent. So these resource agents are like, example will be like IP address 2. This is a kind of resource agent where you can have an IP address as a resource, or stone it, that like a fencing resource. So this, in the resource layer you have all the resource running. Now moving ahead with the resource agent or RA. So resource agents are usually programs, and you can say like mostly they are shell script, and resource agents can start, stop, monitor your various applications it manages. So like it can start a application or it can stop, like how I was giving you previous example, right? Web server. So it can start the web server, stop it, and monitor also it. And one more thing you need to remember here, that these resource agents or RA, you say, they are dedicated to a particular type of service. So if it is like IP ADDR2, so that is only related to IP address. It will not be going for any other type of service. So that's you need to keep in mind. And one more thing you need to remember, this resource agents are called by local resource manager or LRM. So already you have seen that in our previous slide, where CRM calls LRM, then LRM calls RA, and whatever value this resource agent gets, like exit value, that value goes back to CRM, like whether it's successfully started or not, or it failed or it stopped. So that value is sent it back to CRM. Now resource agent provider. So you have seen resource agents, but what is resource agent provider? So resource agent providers are nothing but the providing facts which you can use to configure your resources. So there is a 5 resource agent providers. First one is Open Cluster Framework or OCF. So if you have OCF format or provider available for any service or application you should first use that. That's what is recommended. Then second one is your Linux standard base or LSB. So this is being provided by all the operating systems and found in your etc init.d. Then you have systemd, these are all directly managed systemd services. And fourth one is your service, similar like systemd, this also related to services, but the service works both with systemd, init and upstart. So if you have a mix of application or service types in your cluster, better to use this service. And then there is a special case of provider that's called Stonit. So Stonit are mainly used for fencing related resources. So we'll see about Stonit in more details in our upcoming slides. Now you can have a third party resource agents also. So some applications, they provide their own resource agent. So if you are having those things, that is better, and it makes you much more easier to integrate your application or resource with your cluster if you are having a third party resource agent for those particular application. Like suppose if you take SAP, if they're providing a resource agent, it will be easy for you to integrate that with cluster. As I was telling you, Stonit. So what is Stonit? So Stonit is the shorter form of suit the other node in the head. So what is this? So this is a fencing mechanism, and pacemaker provides you the Stonit. So what it does, so it provides a node level fencing mechanism. And fencing, why it's required, is required because if there's a problem occurs and a node must be denied access to a cluster resource, it goes and shut down that node or cut it out of cluster so that it don't get access to the resource. Like suppose you have a file system, shared file system, so it is getting mounted in a node, and then that node had some issue, so you need to move your resource from that node to some other node. So until that node release this shared file system, you will not be able to mount it in another node. So Stonit comes into picture in this case. It comes and power up that node or shut down that node or cut it out of the cluster so that resource gets released from that node, and then you move ahead and mount that into the another node where you are moving the service. Then we'll move to the storage part. So there is one concept called DLM or distributed lock manager. So it provides you a generic cluster wide locking facility and allow you to use the active storage. So like you want to use same shared disk and mount it on all the nodes at the same time and read and write at the same time to the file system, in that case DLM comes into picture. So it utilizes pacemaker cluster membership service that runs in user space. So it runs as a resource on each cluster node. Now as you saw DLM, there is one more concept called cluster logical volume manager. So LVM, you know logical volume manager. So, but if you are using shared file system and on top of that LVM, and you want to use it with cluster, you should have this clustered LVM running. So here you have the daemon called LVM lockd. That is a newer version OS, you'll find this. If you are using old one, that's a CLVMD. So in your SUSE new one, that 15.1, or you go with OpenSUSE Leap 15.1, there you'll see this LVM lockd is being replaced. LVM lockd replaced that CLVMD. And LVM lockd introduced, as I was telling you, with SUSE 15HA, or you say like OpenSUSE Leap 15. So it is in the newer version. Older version you'll still go with a CLVMD, and it used with LVM2 in cluster environment, as I was telling you. And why we need to use this, it protects the LVM metadata on a shared storage so that they don't get corrupted. So I'll tell you one example. Like suppose you have a shared disk, right? So what do? You attach it into node 1 and node 2 both. And if you create a file system with cluster enabled on cluster flag enabled on that disk as LVM, then you no need to go and create it again on the other node. You just scan it, so you will see automatically that LVM information came there also. So this cluster things you should enable if you want to use your file system with cluster, else what happens, you will not be able to manage it with cluster. And locking type also you should change it in to 3 so that cluster can understand and LVM can also cooperate with cluster and let it manage. Now moving ahead to the end of the video, so thank you for watching this lengthy video. Hope it helped you to make you understand about the architecture of SUSE, pacemaker, cluster, what all components it has and what is their use, so that you can understand in a better way. And if you are working with a SUSE cluster, then you can handle it in properly. And if you are facing some issues, you can understand which component can be responsible for that, and you can go ahead and have the troubleshooting done. So thanks again, and if you have subscribed to my channel, thank you for that. If you have not subscribed yet, please subscribe to it and press the bell icon so that you get all the notification about upcoming videos. And if you like this video, please like, press the like button and share it with your friends and colleagues so that they can also watch these videos and learn from them. If you don't like, fine, press the unlike button, and you can use the comment sections also to let us know what you like or what you don't like, so that you get a proper feedback and try to improve our upcoming videos accordingly so that they can be more helpful for you. So bye, have a good day. We will see you in our next video.